everybody. Welcome to the Abled Gardener, and I am cleaning out my garden box. I decided to harvest some onions that I had sitting underneath a big squash here. Now, it was a huge squash, and it had produced probably, I don't know, somewhere up to maybe 50 or 60 squash on the plant. So that was more than enough zucchini squash than anybody would need. But the plant was just looking a little ratty. It had grown into the walkway to where I couldn't get through anymore. I had had enough of zucchini squash, plus I have a few other squash plants growing, so I can depend on them to have any additional squash that I want or I need. But underneath the squash plant, there were some onions, and I decided to go ahead and pick them. Now, these onions were growing together. You know, they weren't separated to, you know, make one big onion plant. So I just decided to pull them all up, and I probably got, I don't know, about 8 onion plants. So that's going to be good because I was out of onions in the house, and I don't use a lot of onion, but I like having it around when I do want it. So I've got some onion, and I was able to even get some onion seeds because they were all blooming. So I took the head of the onion and I just shook it into a little Ziploc bag, and I was able to get onion seeds. So if I want to have onions from seed next year, I can do that. So just cleaning up this bed a little bit, and this bed has normally been my herb bed, or the bed that I use for things in the kitchen, herbs and whatnot. And I was thinking what I could put in here, and I have a little nursery, or just a little growing area where I have a lot of different plants. And I was thinking it would be a good idea to just take something from there and put in the bed and get it out of a pot. That way I don't have to try and take care of it or make sure that it's watered every day. Anyway, getting back to what I'm going to be putting in this little garden bed area, since it is free now, I was looking at my nursery and I got to thinking, there, I have a lot of plants that you guys haven't seen yet, and I thought maybe you'd like to see what was in my nursery. It's just a variety of things that I either bought off a sale rack, you know, discount things from Home Depot or Lowe's, and different plants that I picked up at the river when we went to go fishing or swimming. There's just little items I started from seeds, trees and different things like that. So I'll just take you on a quick tour of my nursery and show you what I have in the nursery, and then after that, I'm going to decide what I'm going to put in the bed. Okay. That limb's bugging me. Okay, let me take you over to my nursery and I'll show you what I have. Stay away from me. Well, I'm going to try and stay in the shade as much as possible, and I do have a cinder block bed here, and this is part of the wall, so I don't know if I'll be trying to stand up on the wall or straddle the wall. But this is the first thing I wanted to show you. It's a grapevine. I bought it probably almost 2 weeks ago, and they had it on the markdown rack for 50% off. So I've been wanting to buy a grapevine just sometime when I happen to see one. And lo and behold, this is the particular grapevine that I've been looking for, and it's marked 50% off. So as you can tell, it's got quite a bit of vine already growing out. If you can see all that, it's got quite a bit to it, and it looks like it's all ready to be put up on a trellis. Now, the reason they had it marked for 50% off was because it had a lot of dead leaves on it, and it looked like it was dying. Well, what it had, or what it was dying from, was powdery mildew. Yet another plant in my life that has mildew. But I figured that if anybody could take care of it, I probably could, because I've had so much to do with mildew on my plants this year. So I took a baking soda and water combination. It's the tablespoon of baking soda to a gallon of water. And I mixed that up. The plants are out to get me today. I mixed that up and I sprayed the leaves, I sprayed the stems and all the vine, and I also took off all of the leaves that looked like they were going to die anyway, you know, and that was pretty much all of the plant. So I left it almost completely naked, you know. So I left it almost completely without leaves. So then what I did was I repotted it out of the little 3-gallon pot it was in, and I put it in a 10-gallon pot and started watering it with some compost tea. And it seems like compost tea pretty much, I don't know, it cures all ails when it comes to plants. And it started sending out a lot of new growth. So you can tell, if you can see up here, there's a little patch of new growth up here. And all this green that you can see is new growth because I had pretty much taken all the leaves off of it. And then this whole section here, this whole thing is brand new. So the compost tea and, you know, just bringing it home and taking care of it really, really helped this vine. Let's get back to why I wanted this vine in particular. This is a Thompson seedless, and William Thompson lived in this area back in the 1870s, and he spliced or grafted two vines together to get this Thompson seedless, and he named it after himself. I think what he was going for was he wanted to produce raisins. And what he came up with was a great vine that has these big clusters of green grapes, and they're seedless, and they really taste good. They're a really sweet grape. So just the reason for getting a Thompson seedless was because he lived in this area. Actually, he had a house and a little vineyard where he was doing his experiments on grapes just about 3 miles down the road. And there's a little road marker describing, you know, who he was and what he came up with. So that was my reason for getting a Thompson seedless, was just the historical value, because it originated from this area. And I can come up with some other history. I want to really research this. So I'll come up with some other history about it. And when I do go to plant it, which I am no grape expert in any way. I don't know anything about grapes. When to plant them, where, how to plant them. I don't know anything about it. But when I go to plant it and I find all that stuff out, then I'll make a video and you guys can go with me through that whole process of planting the grape and where I'm going to put it and how I'm going to get it on a trellis. So let's go take a look at some of the other plants I have in my nursery. Other things that are in my nursery, what I'll do is I'll just try and put the plant in front of the camera and I'll try and remember what the names of them are. Now, like I said, a lot of things I just pick up like off the side of the road or down by the river where we fish and swim, things like that. And I had found this particular plant, brought it home. It was only maybe 6 to 8 inches tall. And I didn't have any idea what it was, just that it was really pretty and it was blooming these kind of orangish yellow flowers. Well, I asked online and someone told me what it was, and it's a weed. And so, of course, you know, it's grown like a weed. It's about, I don't know, 2 feet tall now. But it is really pretty. And what the name of it is a velvet-leafed cottonseed. I believe that's the name of it. It's a velvet-leaf cottonseed, and it's a weed. It comes up in different parts of the country, just in cornfields and things like that, and they just rip it out. And I guess one of the things that is really strange about it is when, you know, it does reseed itself, and when the seeds start coming up, you know how when a seed starts to develop and it sends out the two first leaves that are cotyledons, I believe that's how it's pronounced, cotyledons. This one is strange in that one of the leaves, first leaves, is just like a regular, you know, oval shape like a cotyledon is, and the other one is a heart-shaped, like this. So that's how they know when it starts coming up that it's not a sunflower or anything like that. It's one of these weeds, and then they just pick it and throw it away. But I'm going to keep this, even though it's a weed. It's just a really pretty weed to me. And I'm just going to keep it and continue to grow it until I don't want it anymore. And hopefully I don't regret keeping this and that these seed pods open up and all the seeds, you know, fly over my garden. So let me get him out of the way. And I'm kind of going through things that I found first. Now down at the same river, same little area, I was doing some metal detecting. And as I was, I came across some plants growing in the grass and I recognized them. And what it is a juga. It's a low growing ground cover. So this is just wild ajuga. So what I did was I brought it home and put it in this little saucer with some dirt and watered it. And it started growing and it sent up this little shoot. And it had the little purple to blue leaves that a juga has on it. And then it died back. And as it did, I kind of just, I don't know, manipulated the little flower area. And it sent down seeds. And now I have little baby ajugas coming up in the soil, which is, I think is kind of neat. Now I have a juga in my garden and in my yard just growing as a ground cover. And if you want any, you just go to the nursery and you can buy some that's just really low growing. It just grows right across the top of your soil. And at least twice a year it will send up the little purple or bluish bloom. And it just, I think it's a really pretty plant. Now this doesn't do it justice, you know, the real one that you go to the nursery to buy or the domesticated one. This is just something, you know, I was trying to grow and it happened to make it after I got home. But like I said, if you want the domesticated one for your yard, it's really pretty. Covers the ground and keeps the moisture in the soil. It acts just like a living mulch is what it does. So one thing I'm not short on is almond trees. So all you have to do, they're really easy to grow. All you have to do is take an almond and stick it in the soil and water it and you'll have an almond tree. They're just so easy to grow, it's ridiculous. So I have three of them here, just trying to keep them moist because this heat is just drying everything out. Now the almond tree is not a very pretty looking tree. I mean, it lacks a lot in that area. But you do get almonds when they grow up. It would take probably 2 to 3 years for this one to grow up and start producing almonds. And almonds do have the benefit of being really good for you. So while we're on the subject of nut trees, I planted a couple hazelnuts. And you can just buy a hazelnut at your health food store. Go ahead and stick them in the ground and grow a hazelnut tree. It's really easy. And they're just as easy as almonds to grow. And these guys are probably about, I would say they're about 4 to 5 months old. And when they grow up, I'll be having some hazelnuts, which will be really nice. For cooking and different things like that. I really love hazelnuts. Now these little guys are just two palm trees. What I did was I saw a palm tree and I took some of the seeds off of it. I just, you know, ran my hand down. I looked at the seeds and they were so tiny. I was really surprised that the seeds to palm trees were so small. And I think I planted probably about 10 or 12 of the seeds and I only got the two palm trees. So these are probably a tree or a bush that I'm going to have to take inside during the winter time because I don't think they'll take it if there's a frost here. I don't think they'll live through that. Now this little guy, or actually taller guy, is a hardwood cutting off of my butterfly bush. And it's a kind of a purple to pink color in flower. But I took, I think I took 4 or 5 hardwood cuttings, about 4 inches tall. And just put them in some soil, kept them in the greenhouse and kept them moist. And out of the 4 to 5 hardwood cuttings that I took, this was the only one that lived. And I noticed it was the only one growing, so I just threw the other ones away. And this one has grown so much now that it's about 1.5 feet tall and it did bloom last week and the week before that it was blooming. And they do attract bees and they attract butterflies. So it's really nice to have in your garden. The other thing that I noticed with my butterfly bush is praying mantises seem to put their little egg sacs on my butterfly bush. I haven't found praying mantises to do that with any other plant that I have in my yard. Okay, behind me is 4 maidenhair ferns, and I don't need to bring all of them out here, but I had purchased a maidenhair fern and kept it inside, and I guess it was under the heater vent and it died. So when I found out where it was, or that it wasn't in the place it was supposed to be, I put it in the greenhouse and it started sending out these new fronds. And then one day I was in Lowe's or Home Depot someplace and saw that there were maidenhair ferns for sale for $1 a piece, and they were dead. They looked like, you know, like this, with nothing on them. So I put them in the greenhouse also, and they've sent out all these fronds. So I don't know what I'm gonna do with all these maidenhair ferns, but they're really pretty. They're nice to have outside, and they do live in this area. They will make it through the winter. The other little tree I have is just a little dwarf juniper tree, and this is meant to go in like a little bonsai garden, something like that. And I was going to try that at one time, and I just haven't gotten around to it. And let's see, back here I just have a couple liriope, and these are just something that your landscaper would put in your yard. It's just a all-purpose landscape plant. Comes up and it looks like, oh, just a clump of grass, and then at the end of the year, near fall, it'll send up a couple little shoots, and it'll have purple flowers on those shoots that come up. So they're really pretty if you take care of them and you keep them watered. And I'm just keeping these guys alive right now until I can find a place to put them in the ground. Another thing I started from seed was a little pine tree. And these are really easy to grow too. You wouldn't think a pine tree would be easy to grow. And here's another couple trees, and I have no idea what they are. I've asked online before, but I forgot what someone said, what they thought it was. I'll bring it up and show you the leaf and see if you guys can tell me what that is. It started coming up, and at about 2 or 3 inches, I dug them up, put them in a couple of pots, and this one actually split. And it has two branches going out. And then this one doesn't have just but the one branch. So that'll be the trunk of the tree. And at some point, I'll cut it off so it'll start branching out. And this is a ground cover that I have. I have some in the yard, but it's not doing real well because it's not getting a lot of water. And this one is. And this is called a plumbago. Now, I'm not sure if it's a blue plumbago or just plumbago. But it just covers the ground. If it has just not a lot of sun, but some sun and enough water, it'll just cover the ground. It can become invasive, but it's really pretty because it gets blue flowers all over the top. Probably at least twice a year it will bloom. So I really like the plumbago. And I just dug this up and put it in here because I wanted to try and save some. I didn't know if the stuff in my yard was going to make it or not.
Okay, so let's get down here by the ginger plant. Now, I bought 2 pieces of ginger at the health food store, and I got them in, I think I put them in a clay pot, and they were drying out. It wasn't doing real well. And I talked to Rob down in Australia, and he thought I should put it in a bigger pot than I had it in and maybe water it a little bit more, keep it in water. And that's what I did. And it's been regrowing, or it's been sending up new shoots. And another thing that I bought at the health food store was a taro root. And I had it in the dirt, or I had it in the soil for a long time, and it didn't do anything at all until I looked it up, and it said that it needed a lot of water. And so I got a little bottom for it, and I'm keeping it just sitting in water, and it started shooting up this little thing out of the middle. So I thought, that's great. It's starting to grow. And that was a couple of days ago that I noticed that. And now there's another growth coming out of the ground over here. And I see another one down here on the side. And even on the top, there's a couple more little green specks. So since I've put it in a lot of water, it's growing really fast. I've got a couple avocado trees. And this is just one of them. The others must be inside in the greenhouse. But this is, I don't know, at least 6 or 7 months old. It's not growing super fast, but it's really healthy and it's pretty, and just trying to keep that guy growing. Well, further down here, I have a blueberry bush. And there's a little ripe blueberry right there, but it's really tiny. Now, the blueberries that this had on it this year were really big. They were about the size of this cherry tomato here, and they tasted really good. So just bringing it home, putting it in a different pot and watering it, and it's been shooting out all this new growth up here on all the stems, and then this right here. And this is my little sweet potato that I've been getting slips off of. And it's the only potato that I've been getting slips off of. It was covered at one time, and I've just been breaking them off, and I've been putting them in a little part of my garden bed in some mulch, and they're doing really well. So it's about time to take this little guy off and put him over there too. And then no doubt it will send up another one. But I've only needed this one potato to get potato slips off of. And I'm really glad that I was able to do that because I've been wanting to grow sweet potatoes, and I haven't been able to grow them from any sweet potato that I bought. Now my daughter gave me that one, and she just called me and asked me, you know, if I wanted it because it was starting to grow. And I said, absolutely, yes. You don't know how long I've been trying to grow sweet potato slips and haven't been able to. Here's something that I found at the river, and this is a datura, and it is poisonous, and as I understand, every bit of it is poisonous. The leaves, the roots, the flowers, seed pods, anything. So I've talked to the kids about it and told them not to get near it or anything like that. And I've also talked to them about being at the river, not to get around the plant at all. You know, if they happen to get any of it on themselves, then to, you know, get in the river or the creek and get washed off. And I really don't know why I'm keeping it, except for when it was blooming, it had the most beautiful blooms on it. The blossoms were just gorgeous with the white and the purple kind of swirled around. But I think it'll probably find itself in the dumpster here before too long, now that it's bloomed. I don't really need to keep anything that's poisonous in my yard. So we'll get down here to the end, and I picked these up for 50% off. What they are is avocado trees, and they're the type of avocado that is supposed to produce fruit in Northern California or in, you know, colder climates. It doesn't have to be down south or in a tropic zone. They should be putting on avocados here where I live. This is a avocado Mexicola, and this one is an avocado Stewart. So as I understand it, they're supposed to produce up here in Northern California. I have a Meyer lemon tree, or actually a dwarf Meyer's lemon, and my husband gave it to me last year. It had two lemons on it, and I put it in the greenhouse inside. I didn't know what to do with it, and I believe it has bloomed and put on lemons three times since I've had it. And I don't think I've even had it a year. So the first blooms and lemons, the lemons fell off. They just dried up and fell off. And these are the second set of lemons, these little guys right here. And then in the last couple weeks, it's gotten new blossoms on it. So it's gonna bloom and put on lemons again. This little guy is, well, not little guy, but this plant is my canna plant that I grew from a seed. Now, usually what you do with cannas is you dig up a rhizome that's down in here. It's just like an iris that where you would dig it up and you'd break the rhizome in two. But it does get seeds on it after it blooms, and I wanted to see if I could grow one from seed. And it's not super easy to grow a canna from seed. They're like, they're the size of about a pea, and they're jet black, and they have two hard coatings on them. So you soak the seed, and you can get that outside coating off, and then you keep soaking it, and then take it out, and after a couple days, you take like the edge of a knife, and you scrape some more of that black coating off until you start seeing some of the white of the embryo. And then you can leave it in water and see if it will root, or put it in a moist paper towel in a little bag, in a little Ziploc bag, and you can see it'll start growing in there. Now, all my other seeds rotted, but this was one that did come up, and I was so proud of it. It was just a little guy, and I was hoping it would live. And now it is sent up, well, this is the main stalk. Now it's sent up three more out of the ground. So I'm very happy with that. I'm happy I was able to grow it. And I know what color it is because I got the seeds from it, and it's a little red canna. Well, not little. It's a very tall red flowered canna. This last plant is a hibiscus, and I believe you guys have seen the flower of this before. It's really taking it hard, this heat up here. I mean, it's just getting sunburned like crazy. And the little blossom pods are starting to fall off before they even bloom. But I think almost everybody knows the look of a hibiscus, like a Hawaiian hibiscus. And they were just the most beautiful flowers. But like I said, with this heat, it's just, you know, the leaves are falling off, the blossoms are falling off. It's just not taking it really well. So I have a couple things inside in the greenhouse. I'll show you those, and then that'll be it. Well, I decided to bring some of these guys outside instead of taking you in where it's dark, where the greenhouse is. So this little guy is a columbine, and it's a really great plant for somewhere like up in the mountains where it's colder. It grows really well in a colder environment, and it does send up shoots, and it will be covered with just the most gorgeous blue, bluish purple blooms all over it. or blossoms. And it's a really pretty blossom. But that would be good for a place other than down here in the valley. But when this one bloomed, I took some of the seeds from it, and I started some little baby columbine. So that's what these guys are. And they're about a month old. They don't grow very fast. But I've got, I believe, 4 little baby columbine, and I'll grow those and keep them in a shady place. And these are some of my Meyer lemons. Someone had given us some lemons, and they were really big and really juicy. They had so much juice in them, I was just surprised. So I took some of the seeds out, and I went through a process of soaking the seeds and different things, and I'll show you guys sometime what I did. But I took 16 to 20 seeds somewhere along there, and I planted them hoping that I would get a lemon tree to come up, and all of the seeds came up. So at one time I thought I had 16 little Meyer lemon trees, but I actually have more like 18 or 19, and most of them are in the greenhouse. I just brought out this tray. So I'm hoping to get a nice looking tree out of some of these since there are so many. This last little guy I'll show you is a fig tree, and this is another thing that was down by the river. It was growing just on the side of the river. I took 2 cuttings off of it and put them here in some potting soil and vermiculite and kept it moist. The leaves dried up and fell off, and I thought they were going to die. And then I've noticed, just in the last, couple days, that they're starting to send out little shoots. This one on this side and on the top, and this one is just starting to come out the top. So it looks like, at least with this one anyway, this one looks really healthy. This one I'm not real sure about, but it looks like I'm going to have a little fig tree, and I really wish I knew what kind of fig it was. So that's the end of my nursery as it is. Well, you guys, thanks for joining me today and taking a look at my little nursery and different things that I have growing here. And I hope you were able to see something today that maybe you'd never seen before, or learn something that you didn't know. Other than that, I'm going to go back inside because even though the sun is going down, it was 102, 103 today. It takes a while for the temperature to actually start dropping. And maybe when it cools down later on sometime this week, I'll get a few of these plants and get them in my garden bed where I took that squash out. So other than that, if you guys like the video, then hit like. If you want to subscribe, I appreciate everyone that's subscribed so far to my channel. And I'll just talk to you guys later. So happy gardening, and I'll see ya. Bye, you guys.